Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Gene Machine, The Race to Decipher the Secrets of the Ribosome by Venki Ramakrishnan. Read by Matthew Waterson. Foreword by Jennifer Doudna. This is a personal story of the author's experiences as a student, professor, and avid experimentalist, seeking to understand how cells carry out one of the most ancient and fundamental of activities, the synthesis of proteins. The passion for discovery, the frustration of experiments gone awry, the personal and professional struggles that accompanied the road to scientific success come alive in this engaging account. The author's perspectives are unique in several ways. As an immigrant to America and later to England, and as a physicist entering the world of biology, the story captures the feelings of an outsider yearning to be part of the scientific and social world he observes. This yearning may have played a role in the approach to research that he describes. There is at once a desire to belong and yet a willingness to be a maverick and to embark on a journey of discovery that seemed at the outset to be a long shot. Then there is the scientific discovery itself. Revelatory structures of the very machinery that reads the genetic code and translates its nucleic acid sequence into chains of amino acids that form all of the proteins necessary for life on Earth. The ribosome, comprised of one large and one small subunit, is uncovered in all its glory, with the author's own work revealing the molecular underpinnings of the decoding mechanism of a ribosomal small subunit and the means by which multiple antibiotic drugs block the action of the bacterial ribosome and thereby eliminate microbial infections. The process of determining structures of the ribosomal small subunit, from initial efforts with individual components to later tour de force attempts to purify and crystallize the intact small subunit, is a fascinating tale of ingenuity, luck, and ultimate success. The story is also one of professional dilemmas, the serendipity of discovery, and the deeply human nature of research, in which personalities play an essential role. Any major scientific breakthrough involves multiple contributors, as well as the interactions of scientists grappling with the challenges of discovery and setback that accompany the winding path to understanding. It is not always clear how ideas emerge, whether they are truly one's own, or instead an outcrop of discussions with others. Sometimes competition comes between colleagues and must be managed, even as the joy of discovery is at hand. The award of the 2009 Nobel Prize in Chemistry gave recognition to the early success with ribosome crystallization by Ada Yonath and the subsequent achievements of Venki Ramakrishnan and Tom Stites in solving the structures of the ribosomal subunits. Yet, as described in the book, others who made key contributions were, by the three recipient limitation of the prize, left out of this recognition, despite the importance of their insights. The book provides a layman's account of the author's experiences and views on these matters that must be taken in the spirit of a memoir rather than an objective historical essay. Students of science and of the scientific method will find this story to be a fresh take on the process of discovery and the sometimes tortuous trail that leads to new knowledge. In the end, it is a fascinating contribution to the scientific literature and one that will be valued as both a description of fact and a dissection of the emotional side of a scientist's approach and eventual achievement. J. A. Doudna. Prologue. Looking back, it is surprising how little effect her visit had. It was a grey autumn day in 1980. A small advertisement on a Yale University notice board had announced a lecture with a vague title. I had no trouble finding a seat, even though I arrived just before the speaker, because only a few specialists had bothered to come. She strode in exuding confidence, even audacity. After a brief introduction by her host, she began to describe the efforts of her group in Berlin to obtain crystals of an enormous assembly of molecules involved in translating genes into proteins. At the time, obtaining crystals was a key step to deciphering their structure. After her talk, there were hardly any questions because we weren't sure what to make of her work. We thought it was astonishing that someone had coaxed such a large and floppy particle to form the regular three-dimensional stacks of molecules that make up a crystal. As we walked down the hall back to our labs, a colleague of mine teased another, saying, "How come you can't even crystallize a tiny piece of it, and she's done the whole thing?" However, her crystals were not good enough to obtain a structure, and at the time, nobody even knew how to figure out the structure for something so large. So in the end, we thought it was an interesting curiosity, but none of us felt that our world had changed and we needed to drop what we were doing. Little did I know that the scientist, Ada Yonath, would figure in my professional life for the next 3 decades, that I would compete with her and others in an intense race to understand an object that is at the heart of all life, or that one December, I would be sitting between her and the Crown Princess of Sweden at a Nobel Prize banquet in Stockholm. Chapter 1. An Unexpected Change of Plans in America. When I left India, I had my heart set on becoming a theoretical physicist. I was 19 years old and had just graduated from Baroda University. It was customary to stay on to get a master's degree in India before going abroad for a PhD, but I was eager to go to America as soon as I could. To me, it was not only the land of opportunity, but also of rational heroes like Richard Feynman, whose famous Lectures on Physics had been part of my undergraduate curriculum. Besides, my parents were already there, as my father was taking a short sabbatical at the University of Illinois in Urbana. Since this was a last-minute decision, I had not taken the GRE exam that is a requirement for American graduate schools, and most universities would not even consider my application. The physics department at the University of Illinois initially accepted me, but when the graduate college found out I was only 19, they said that, at best, I could join as an undergraduate with 2 years of college credit. No middle-class Indian, then, could afford the cost of tuition and living in America. In the meantime, my department chair in Baroda showed me a letter from Ohio University asking him to let prospective graduate students know about its program. I'd never heard of Ohio University before, but saw that the department had an IBM System 360 computer and a Van de Graaff accelerator, and that its faculty had been trained at some of the best universities. That seemed good enough for me. They waived the usual GRE requirement and accepted me with financial support. After the typically nerve-wracking interview for a student visa at the U.S. Consulate in Bombay, I bought my ticket to the Promised Land. As soon as I had finished my final exams, I left the sweltering heat of India and set off for America. I had caught a fever, and the flight seemed interminable, stopping at Beirut, Geneva, Paris, and London before landing in New York. I boarded a plane for Chicago and then took a short flight to Champaign-Urbana. As I stepped out onto the tarmac on the evening of May 17, 1971, I felt a blast of the coldest wind I had ever experienced. My sudden immersion into American college life came as something of a shock. College life in India was fairly staid. Students were conservative in their attire and focused on their studies. Many, like me, still lived with their parents. Dating, and especially premarital sex, was quite unusual. I arrived as a geeky student with a crew cut, glasses with thick black plastic frames, and orange suede shoes, 2 sizes too large, into an America that, in 1971, was a continuation of the 60s. American students seemed to belong to an entirely different species. The males in tattered jeans and hair even longer than the females, who, in their hot pants and halter tops, seemed almost naked compared to the Indian women I had just left behind. Campuses throughout America were protesting against the Vietnam War. One afternoon, out of a mixture of curiosity and sympathy, I attended a peace rally. I stuck out like a sore thumb, but then found 2 older guys at the back, who, like me, had short hair and were dressed in the same cheap polyester trousers and shirts. I walked over to them and tried to be friendly, but they were rather curt and suspicious. Only later did I find out that they were FBI agents keeping an eye on the anti-war troublemakers. I spent the summer taking courses at the University of Illinois, filling gaps in my education from Baroda. At the end of the summer, I drove with my parents and sister to the pretty and hilly university town of Athens in southern Ohio, which was to be my home for the next few years. The first problem was finding any home at all. Since I had to live on my teaching assistantship and was a vegetarian, I thought it would be best if I rented a small flat where I could cook my own meals. We scoured the newspaper for rental ads with little success. In one case, the landlady said the flat was available, but when we showed up to look at it only a few minutes later, she took one look at me and said it was just taken. That was my first experience of racism in America. Unable to find a flat that weekend, I signed up for a dorm room and spent the first year living primarily on cheese sandwiches at the cafeteria. Notwithstanding its culinary disadvantages, the dorm room had the great benefit of allowing me to instantly acquire a group of friends and avoid the feeling of isolation and ghettoization so common to foreigners. My dorm mates quickly helped me assimilate into American college life. The first Saturday, we went to a football game. The pomp, with cheerleaders, bands, and the loud PA system, seemed to dwarf the game itself. The dorm also had the advantage of being close to the physics department, and several fellow graduate students lived in rooms nearby, so we were able to form a friendly study group and get used to graduate school together. Physics graduate students generally have to do a year or two of coursework, followed by a comprehensive exam, before they begin serious research. Although I finished my coursework and the written part of the comprehensive exam without too many problems, the oral part at the end gave me the first inkling that I did not have a burning desire to be a physicist. I was asked what recent interesting discoveries in physics I had read about. I couldn't name even one, and only after some prodding could I even name an area I found interesting. They passed me anyway, and I decided to work under the supervision of Tomoyasu Tanaka, a well-regarded condensed matter theorist. By then, I had already become intrigued by biological questions, and I included some biological problems in my thesis proposal. Since neither Tomoyasu nor I knew the slightest thing about biology, these proposals were pure fantasy, and I soon abandoned them. As I began my thesis work, I realized that I could not quite see how to identify key questions, let alone how to approach them. Even worse, I didn't find my work interesting. I retreated into my social life, playing on the university chess team, going hiking with my friend, Sudhir Kaika, learning about Western classical music from another friend, Tony Grimaldi, and generally doing anything except making progress on my graduate work. Tomoyasu was an almost stereotypically polite Japanese who would occasionally come into my office to delicately inquire about my progress, and I would tell him in a roundabout way that there hadn't been any. This continued for a couple of years. I've often said that if I'd had students like me, I would have fired them. Things suddenly changed when I met Vera Rosenberry, a recently separated woman with a 4-year-old daughter. Some mutual friends decided that the two of us should meet, perhaps because we were both vegetarians, an oddity in 1970s southern Ohio. I was completely oblivious that our first meeting was a setup because we were part of a large Thanksgiving gathering. Observing my cluelessness, my friends decided I needed additional help and invited me to a dinner party with just one other couple. Vera struck me as both intelligent and classically good-looking, but I assumed someone like her would be out of my league and couldn't possibly be interested in me, so I tried to introduce her to a friend by inviting him to dinner along with Vera and her daughter, Tanya. I spent some of that time playing with Tanya so that my friend and Vera could be free to chat. It was my friend who had to point out that she seemed interested in me, not him, and if anything, she probably became even more interested when she saw how well I got along with her daughter. Despite this comically inept start on my part, we began a stormy courtship that lasted less than a year, and got married soon after her divorce became final. At the age of 23, I found myself married and the stepfather of a 5-year-old girl. Marriage, however, focused my mind on my career. Vera wanted to have another child, so I faced the prospect of supporting a family without any idea of what I would do next. There seemed no question that if I stayed on in physics, I would spend the rest of my life doing boring and incremental calculations that wouldn't result in any real advance in understanding. Biology, on the other hand, was undergoing the sort of dramatic transformation that physics had in the early 20th century. The revolution in molecular biology that began with the structure of DNA was still going strong, and we were beginning to get fundamental insights into the molecular basis of biological processes that had puzzled us for centuries. Almost every single issue of Scientific American would report some major breakthrough in biology, and it seemed as if it could be done by mere mortals like me. My problem was that I knew only the most basic biology and had no idea what biological research entailed. So, even before I'd finished my physics PhD, I made the difficult decision to attend graduate school all over again, this time in biology, taking heart from the fact that many illustrious scientists like Max Perutz, Francis Crick, and Max Delbruck had made a similar transition. I wrote to several top-tier universities, but many of them did not want to accept someone who already had a PhD into graduate school. Two replies were particularly memorable. The first, from Franklin Hutchinson at Yale, was a friendly letter saying that although they couldn't accept me as a graduate student, he would send around my CV to his faculty in case someone was interested in hiring me as a postdoctoral research fellow. Two of them wrote back, Don Engelman and, ironically in hindsight, Tom Steitz. I thanked them both and said that I didn't have enough background to be useful to them as a postdoc and would try to acquire some training first. At the opposite end of the spectrum from Hutchinson was James Bonner of Caltech. In my applications, I had written that because I was only 23, I was young enough to go to graduate school again. Bonner berated me for bragging about my age, adding that he too was only 23 when he received his PhD and was considered backward in his family. He also said that the areas I had mentioned, allostery, membrane proteins, and neurobiology, were hardly surprising because they were the most fashionable areas of biology. If I wanted to work in them, he wrote, I had to first show that I could actually be competent in those areas, and certainly Caltech would not accept me as a student. Perhaps he had never read Catch-22. Fortunately for me, Dan Lindsley of UC San Diego was willing to accept me into the biology department as a graduate student with a fellowship. Even more fortunately, Vera and Tanya were game to move to California and continue living on a meager graduate student stipend with the added burden of an infant, all without a car. Somehow I scraped together enough work to produce a passable thesis just in time. Our son Raman was born just a month after my PhD exam. A couple of weeks later, a friend and I drove from Ohio to California in a Ryder truck with all our belongings, and Vera and the children flew in with my mother-in-law a week later. Once we'd settled in, I began my studies in earnest in the autumn of 1976. The thing that immediately struck me about biology was how many facts you have to know. The introductory lectures for new graduate students were full of jargon I didn't understand at all. To catch up, I took a full load of undergraduate courses in genetics, biochemistry, and cell biology, in addition to doing first-year graduate student rotations, which are short, 6-week projects that American grad students typically do before they settle into a lab for their PhD research. Because my physics research had been entirely theoretical, I was totally ignorant of laboratory work. This was brought home to me during a rotation in Milton Sayer's lab, which worked on sugar uptake by bacteria. The experiment entailed adding a certain amount of radioactive glucose to a culture of bacteria at time zero, and then measuring how much glucose had entered the bacteria at various time points. The amount of the glucose to be added was much smaller than anything I'd encountered before, only about 20 microliters, less than 1% of the volume of a teaspoon. How could you measure such a small volume? I asked. The technician who was training me very pleasantly showed me a device called a pipetman, which is essentially a tube with a piston that can be set so that it can go up or down by a precise amount. She showed me how to set the volume on the dial, how to draw up the right amount, and how to give the knob a little extra push at the end to make sure all the sample had been ejected. That was all there was to it, she said. I took the device and plunged it into the radioactive glucose, and she exclaimed, What the hell are you doing? You have to use tips. The devices were so commonplace that she'd forgotten to mention the narrow disposable plastic tips that needed to be attached to the end of the pipetman so that it never got contaminated by contact with the sample. Moving with a young child and an infant was not exactly conducive to learning a new field. However, I was extremely lucky that Vera, who was starting her own career as a children's book illustrator, could work from home. She did almost all of the childcare and housework, allowing me to focus on my studies. I ended the first year feeling optimistic that I had a broad enough background in biology and fairly varied lab experience. In my second year, I began work with Mauricio Montal, who was studying proteins that let ions pass through the thin membranes of lipids that envelop all cells. As it turned out, I wouldn't stay in his lab very long. Almost entirely by chance, I would move across the country yet again to begin work on one of the oldest and most central molecules of life. Chapter 2: Stumbling into the Ribosome. Mention DNA and almost everyone nods in understanding. We all know, or think we know, what DNA means. It determines the essence of who we are and what we pass on to our children. DNA has become a metaphor for the fundamental qualities of almost anything. It is not in their DNA, we say, even when referring to a corporation. But mention the word ribosome, and you will usually be met with a blank stare, even by most scientists. A few years ago, I was told by Quentin Cooper on the BBC radio program Material World that the previous week's guest had been outraged that the eye only merited half a program when an entire episode was planned for a mere molecule like the ribosome. Of course, not only are most of the components of the eye made by the ribosome, but virtually every molecule in every cell in every form of life is either made by the ribosome or made by enzymes that are themselves made by the ribosome. In fact, by the time you hear this, the ribosomes in each of the trillions of cells in your body will have churned out thousands of proteins. Millions of life forms exist without eyes, but every one of them needs ribosomes. The discovery of the ribosome and its role in making proteins is the culmination of one of the great triumphs of modern biology. When I arrived in California to learn biology, like most physicists, I had no idea what the ribosome was, and only the vaguest idea of what a gene was. I knew genes carried the traits we inherited from our ancestors and passed on to our offspring. But I learned that genes are much more. They are the units of information that allow a whole organism to develop from a single cell, like a fertilized egg. Although nearly all cells contain a full set of genes, different sets of genes are turned on or off in different tissues. So a hair or skin cell is very different from a liver or brain cell. But what actually are genes? Broadly speaking, a gene is a stretch of DNA that contains information on how and when to make a protein. Proteins carry out thousands of functions in life. For example, they are what make muscles move. They let us sense light, touch, and heat, and help us fight off diseases. They carry oxygen from our lungs to our muscles. Even thinking and remembering is made possible by proteins. Many proteins called enzymes catalyze the chemical reactions that make the thousands of other molecules in the cell. So ultimately, proteins not only give a cell its structure and shape, but also enable it to function. Understanding how the information in a piece of DNA could be used to make a protein was the culmination of an exciting decade that began with the classic 1953 paper on the double helical structure of DNA by James Watson and Francis Crick. Often, the structure of a molecule does not immediately explain how it works. Not so with DNA, which immediately suggested both how it could carry information and how it could reproduce itself. It had long been a mystery how information in a cell is duplicated when it divides, or how offspring inherit this information when an organism reproduces. In each molecule, the two strands of DNA that intertwine to form a double helix run in opposite directions. Each strand has a backbone of alternating sugar and phosphate groups, and one of four types of bases, A, T, C, or G, is attached to the sugar and faces the inside of the helix. While playing with cardboard cutouts of the bases, Watson arrived at a brilliant insight. He realized that an A on one strand could chemically bond or pair to a T on the other, but not to any of the other bases, while a G on one strand could similarly pair with a C on the other. In doing so, the shape of each base pair whether it was AT or CG, was about the same, which meant that regardless of the order of the bases, the overall shape and dimensions of the double helix was about the same. This formation of base pairs meant that the order of the bases on one strand would precisely specify the order on the other strand. When cells divided, the two strands would separate, and each would have the information to serve as a template to make the other strand, resulting in two copies of the DNA molecule from one. In this way, genes were able to duplicate themselves. After centuries, we finally understood in molecular terms how hereditary traits could be transmitted from generation to generation. The structure immediately suggested how genes could be duplicated and passed on, but not how the information in our genes could actually be used to make proteins. The problem was that each strand of DNA was a long chain made up of building blocks containing the four types of bases. But proteins are completely different chains made up of amino acids, and their chemical linkage is completely different. Their enormous variety comes from the fact that there are 20 types of amino acids, which have a wide range of chemical properties. The length and order of amino acids in each protein chain is unique, and amazingly, it contains the information needed for the chain to fold up into its own unique shape, which allows it to carry out its special function. Crick realized that the order of bases in DNA coded for the order of amino acids in a protein, but the question was how? Lots of people worked on this problem for well over a decade. It turns out that a stretch of DNA containing a gene is copied into a related molecule called messenger RNA, or mRNA, so-called because the molecule carries the genetic message to where it is needed. RNA, which stands for ribonucleic acid, differs from DNA, or deoxyribonucleic acid, by having an extra oxygen in the sugar ring. It, too, has four bases, but the base thymine, T, in DNA is replaced by a very similar base, uracil, U, in RNA, which, like T, also base pairs with A. How do you go from four types of bases to 20 types of amino acids? It would be like following a long sentence of instructions written in code using a foreign alphabet. It turns out that the bases are read in groups of three at a time, and each group is called a codon. The way they are read, something predicted by Crick, is that another RNA molecule called transfer RNA, or tRNA, has an appropriate amino acid attached at one end and a group of three bases called an anticodon at the other end. The anticodon and codon form base pairs just like the ones between the two strands of DNA. The next codon is recognized by a different tRNA, which brings along its amino acid, and so on. The next big discovery was that this doesn't happen by itself. Cell biologists discovered particles in cells where the mRNA is read and proteins are made. The particles were tiny by normal standards. You could pack 4,000 of them in the width of a human hair. There were thousands of them in every cell, from bacteria to humans, but they were enormous in molecular terms. Each of them contained about 50 proteins and three large pieces of their own RNA, a third type of RNA, after mRNA and tRNA. Initially, scientists referred to the particles as ribonucleoprotein particles of the microsomal fraction because they were made up of both RNA and protein and were isolated from cellular fragments known as microsomes. This was quite a mouthful to say. So, in the late 1950s at a conference, Howard Dintzis suggested the name ribosome, which it has been called ever since. Dintzis was also the first person to figure out the direction in which a protein chain is made. Embarrassingly, even after working for 30 years in the field, I didn't know Dintzis or his work. When I finally met him in 2009 at Johns Hopkins University, where I had been invited to give a lecture named after him, he was still justifiably proud of having coined the word. The whole ribosome has over a million atoms. Because it is the link between our genes and the proteins they specify, the ribosome lies at the very crossroads of life. Even though everyone knew this, nobody had any idea what ribosomes looked like other than that they were blobs consisting of two parts. And that was a real problem. Somehow, the ribosome bound mRNA and stitched together the amino acids brought together by the tRNAs into a protein. But without knowing what it looked like, how could we possibly understand how it all worked? Imagine you are a Martian, peering at Earth from above. You observe tiny objects on the surface that move mainly in straight lines, occasionally turning at right angles. If you were able to get a little closer, you might see that these objects move only when even smaller objects enter them and stop moving when they leave. If you have sensors, you could tell that they consume hydrocarbons and oxygen and emit carbon dioxide and water, along with some pollutants and heat. But you'd have absolutely no idea what these objects really are, let alone how they work. Only by knowing the detailed construction of the object would you be able to see that it is made of hundreds of components that work together, and that it has an engine connected to a crankshaft that makes the wheels turn. You would need to see even more detail to know that the engine itself has chambers with pistons and draws in a mixture of fuel and oxygen that is ignited with a spark plug, which drives the piston forward. It is the same with understanding molecules. Knowing the detailed structure of DNA revolutionized our understanding of how it works to store, transmit, and replicate genetic information. But the ribosome was not a simple molecule like DNA. It was enormous and complex and seemed just too daunting and intractable. Many great scientists like Crick, who had played key roles in figuring out how information in DNA is encoded, simply gave up on the ribosome and left for other fields. Sidney Brenner, an equally eminent colleague of Crick's, who was one of the discoverers of mRNA, said in the 1960s that the structure of the ribosome was a trivial problem and there was no need to work on it in Cambridge, since that sort of work would, of course, be done by Americans. This reminds me of Senator George Aiken saying of the intractable Vietnam War that the US should declare victory and get out. One of the early molecular biologists who persisted on the ribosome was Watson, who worked on the problem with Alfred Tissier, a biochemist from Geneva who was visiting his lab. Nearly 40 years later, at a meeting in Cold Spring Harbor in 2001, Watson recalled those early days, saying that when he realized how complex the ribosome was, he automatically knew that we would never know its structure. The ribosome was far from my mind as I settled into Mauricio Montal's lab. But after I had only been there a few months, I came across an article on the ribosome in Scientific American that would change my life. It described how to locate the many different proteins on the ribosome using neutron scattering, a technique known to physicists but hardly used in biology. The two authors were Don Engelman and Peter Moore, and I remembered that Don was one of the people who had expressed interest in having me as a postdoc when I was trying to switch from physics to biology. I thought if he'd wanted me with no biological background at all, he might be even more interested now that I had learned some biology and had over a year of lab experience. It also occurred to me that I had already learned enough biology to do research in the field, and that there was no need to get a second PhD in biology. So I wrote to Don, reminding him of our previous correspondence, saying I was now more prepared for a postdoc. Since I knew Don's main interest, like Mauricio's, was in membranes and proteins in membranes, I told him I would like to work on them in his lab. He wrote back, saying that he didn't have any positions, but his collaborator Peter Moore did, and if I came there and worked on ribosomes, I could then do some membrane work in my spare time. By that time, I knew that ribosomes were fundamentally important, so I said that was fine with me. As it turned out, the spare time was non-existent. Peter soon wrote, saying he was visiting San Diego for a conference and would be happy to meet me. When I went downtown to see him, he was dressed in his characteristically preppy clothes, with a brown corduroy jacket, and his thick glasses and manner completed the stereotype of an Ivy League intellectual, which indeed he was. He entered the fast track early in life and never left it, and I was never sure whether he really understood what it was like not to have been in elite institutions all your life. His father had made pioneering contributions to transplantation surgery at Harvard, and Peter himself had studied at a private school and then Yale before going to Harvard for grad school, where he worked with Watson on the ribosome. After that, he went to work with Watson's friend and collaborator, Alfred Tissier, in Geneva, who by then was a leader in the ribosome field. There, he set about purifying the different proteins that made up the ribosome, realizing that the key to understanding the ribosome was knowing its structure, and that he needed to acquire skills in structural analysis, he left Geneva to go to the Medical Research Council, MRC Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge, England. This lab was the direct descendant of the MRC unit where Watson and Crick had done their work on DNA, and by then had become a mecca for studying the structures of all kinds of biological molecules. Americans referred to the lab as the MRC, as if it was the only one of the many labs that the Medical Research Council supported throughout the country that was worth knowing about. The British called it the MRC LMB, or simply the LMB, as it is currently known. At the end of his stint at the LMB, Peter returned as a faculty member to his alma mater, Yale, where he has been ever since. He has a dry wit with a reservoir of knowledge that ranges from all aspects of science to history and the classics. Although a shy and reserved man, he lost his natural reticence when it came to science. His lectures were articulate and laced with humor, and generations of Yale students and scientists were exposed to his wrath when they presented sloppy arguments. At the conference in San Diego where we first met, he was standing by himself, waiting for me while people were milling about him. After a brief hello, we chatted about my background and his project. I wasn't at all sure how this informal interview had gone, but he wrote back soon afterwards to invite me to visit Yale. My visit there was very pleasant. Despite my obvious naivete, Peter formally offered me a position, and I accepted immediately. I spent the rest of the academic year finishing up work in Mauricio's lab. Finally, at the end of the summer, I left for New Haven, picking up my family en route in Ohio, where they had spent the previous few weeks. I arrived in Peter's lab in the autumn of 1978 with some trepidation. Faced with actually having to do postdoctoral research at Yale, my earlier confidence evaporated because, despite my 2 years of grad school in biology, I had very limited experience in actual biological research. A few days after I arrived, Peter and I were walking towards each other in a long passageway in the neo-Gothic Stirling Chemistry Laboratory. As soon as we drew close, he suddenly looked away. I was worried that he'd already regretted hiring me. But his longtime technician, Betty Rennie, laughed and told me that was just his manner. In any case, he was perfectly nice to me, and a year later, he must have felt I was sufficiently competent that he could leave me alone for an entire year while he went away on sabbatical in Oxford. During his absence, I grew a beard that I kept for almost 25 years. By the time I began working for Peter, some basic facts about the ribosome were already established. All ribosomes have two parts, known as the small and large subunits. The small subunit binds the mRNA containing the genetic information, while the large subunit actually stitches together the amino acids brought in by the tRNAs to make a protein. There are three slots for the tRNAs, one to bring in the new amino acid, one to hold the growing protein chain, and one that is kind of a halfway house before being ejected from the ribosome. During the process, the tRNAs move through the ribosome from one slot to the next, and as they move, they effectively drag the mRNA along with them so that the ribosome is, in effect, moving along the mRNA, helping the tRNAs read one codon after another to make the protein. Each step needs the help of proteins that bind and leave the ribosome at various stages, and each step consumes energy. Because it uses energy and moves during this enormously complicated process, the ribosome is referred to as a molecular machine, or a nanomachine. Apart from its fundamental role at the crossroads of biology between genes and the proteins they specify, there was a practical reason to be interested in the ribosome. Over the years, people had realized that many antibiotics work by blocking the ribosome at different steps. Because the ribosomes of humans are sufficiently different from those of bacteria, some of these antibiotics preferentially bind to bacterial ribosomes and are useful in treating infectious diseases. Bacteria are increasingly becoming resistant to infections, however, and knowing exactly how an antibiotic binds to the ribosome could lead to designing new and better ones. These basic facts had already made it into textbooks. So when I told people I was working on the ribosome, I would often be asked, but isn't that already done? Sometimes this would be accompanied by a pitying look, as though I was some poor guy dotting the I's and crossing the T's on a problem that was no longer interesting. The reality was that although we had an outline of what a ribosome did, we had no idea how it did even one of the many complicated steps involved in making a protein. It was as if we knew a bit more about a car, realized it had four wheels and windows and a driver who sat at a steering wheel, but knew nothing else about how it actually worked. Like many other fields, science has its fashions, and at any given time, some areas are considered more interesting than others. Often these are new areas where people are making rapid advances. Many scientists move on from a problem as soon as it gets too hard to make further progress. Those who are very creative open up entirely new areas, but others just follow one fashionable area after another. If everyone did this, our understanding of phenomena would be quite superficial. But fortunately, there are other scientists who stick with a problem, no matter how old and difficult it is, to get right to the bottom of things. Even though the ribosome had been studied for a couple of decades, nobody even knew where all the 50 or so proteins in it were located, let alone what they did. Peter was collaborating with Don Engelman to tackle this problem. In some ways, they could not have been more different. In contrast to Peter's reserve, Don was a tall, gregarious California native with a carefully manicured beard and a booming baritone voice and suave manner that conveyed great authority regardless of the topic of conversation. He had gone to Reed College in Portland, done his PhD at Yale, and then gone to do a postdoc with Maurice Wilkins, the third man of DNA, where he worked on the structure of the membranes that envelop all cells. Unlike Peter, who had spent his entire life working on one or other aspect of the ribosome, Don's interests were more varied. Don and Peter heard a talk by Benno Schonburn of Brookhaven National Lab about how neutrons could be used to study biological structures. Neutrons were something only physicists bothered with. Moreover, you needed a nuclear reactor to produce enough neutrons to do an experiment. But the interesting thing about neutrons for biology was that hydrogen and its heavier isotope, deuterium, interact very differently with neutrons, and hydrogen makes up half the atoms in biological molecules like proteins and RNA. The talk gave Don and Peter an idea for trying to figure out where the ribosomal proteins were. They realized that if you could somehow make a ribosome in which just two of the proteins had deuterium instead of hydrogen atoms, those two proteins would scatter neutrons differently. You could get deuterated proteins by growing bacteria in heavy water, which is deuterium oxide. Then you would have to reassemble a ribosome in which any two proteins of your choice were deuterated. Masayasu Nomura at Wisconsin had shown that you could biochemically extract the proteins from the small ribosomal subunit and separate each of the 20 proteins from the mixture by chromatography. You could then mix all the components together in a solution and, under the right conditions, you could reassemble a functional small subunit from the purified proteins and RNA. This meant that you could make a small subunit in which just two of the proteins were replaced by their deuterated counterparts. These ribosomal subunits could then be taken to a nuclear reactor in Brookhaven National Lab in the middle of Long Island and exposed to a neutron beam. Each such experiment would give you a distance between a pair of proteins. By measuring distances between lots of different pairs, you could figure out how they were arranged in three dimensions, very much like how early surveyors mapped unknown terrain by triangulation. The project involved tediously making the same kinds of measurements over and over again with different pairs of proteins in the ribosome. I joined the lab when only the first few of the proteins had been located this way, and the baton was handed to me by the previous postdoc, Dan Schindler. To my surprise, I learned that neutron beams, even from a nuclear reactor, are orders of magnitude weaker than X-ray beams, so it would take several days to measure the small signal from the deuterated proteins that was buried in the large overall background scattering from the rest of the ribosome. Doing this work during the summer had advantages. While the data were being collected, I would occasionally go to the beach on Fire Island, a few miles directly south. At other times, being trapped in Brookhaven was not exactly thrilling, because the lab was in an old army camp in the middle of nowhere outside Yafank. The scientists who worked there lived in communities miles away. They were a mixture of rural hamlets and extended suburban sprawl. Unlike a university town with a thriving cultural scene and nightlife, the lab was deserted on evenings and weekends, with nothing for a temporary visitor to do. This situation reminded me of a famous New Yorker cartoon of the Long Island Expressway that said, Exit 66, Yafank. If you have already been to Yafank, please disregard this exit. After about 3 years, a little over half of the proteins were placed in the small subunit, and we wrote a couple of papers on their location. I was wondering how long it would take me to do the remaining ones, but as I approached the end of my fellowship, Don came to me and said it was in my own interest that I move on to the next phase of my career now that I had acquired the training I needed as a postdoc. The project was eventually finished by my successor, Malcolm Capel. The final paper describing the locations of all the proteins showed them as billiard balls superimposed on the shape of the small subunit, and I would joke that about a third of those balls were mine. Responding to Don's hint, I applied for almost 50 faculty positions, but it was not a great time to be looking for jobs. We had just entered the Reagan era of minimal government, and research funding was tight. Biotech was still in its infancy, and faculty jobs were scarce. I applied for every opening from junior colleges to universities of varying quality. The smaller teaching colleges looked at my long Indian name and probably worried I couldn't speak English well enough to teach. The universities looked at my career, a bachelor's and doctorate in physics, neither of which was from a prestigious university, 2 years studying biology without a degree, followed by research using a technique nobody had heard of to work on an old problem that was already unfashionable. No wonder I didn't get a single interview. Luckily, Oak Ridge National Lab in Tennessee had just started a neutron scattering facility and was looking for someone to collaborate with biologists. So Don called up the head of the facility, Wally Kohler, to recommend me. In the excitement and optimism of starting my first real job, Vera and I bought a house there right away. In February of 1982, we packed our stuff into our small Ford Fiesta and drove from New Haven to Tennessee through an ice storm in Pennsylvania. I had gone there on the understanding that I would be able to do my own research, but when I arrived, the biology lab I was promised didn't materialize. Wally Kohler told me that I was there to collaborate with biologists on neutron scattering, not to do my own research. He was a well-known physicist whom I liked personally, but I felt he did not understand the way biology is done and the rather peripheral role neutrons play in biology, and I started looking to leave Oak Ridge very soon after I got there. Luckily for me, Benno Schoenbern, who was developing the biological use of neutrons at Brookhaven National Lab, and who had inspired Peter and Don to work on the ribosome, came to the rescue. He offered me an independent job at Brookhaven, which, given my situation in Oak Ridge, I was grateful to accept. So, only 15 months after our arrival in Oak Ridge, we sold our house for a substantial loss in the summer of 1983 and moved back to the East Coast, this time to Long Island. Vera was not happy at leaving her beautiful garden and idyllic life in Oak Ridge, and her heart sank when we drove over the George Washington Bridge and saw all the traffic on the Long Island Expressway. We eventually found a house in East Patchogue, right next to the village of Bellport, on the south shore of Long Island. It was a 12-mile commute each way to the lab and seemed much longer during the ice storms every winter. Unlike my disastrous experience in Oak Ridge, Brookhaven gave me a well-equipped lab, a technician, and freedom to carry out my own research. My colleagues were very friendly and helpful, but made it clear that I shouldn't expect to get tenure for merely continuing work I had done as a postdoc. Fortunately, as a result of collaborations during my brief stint in Oak Ridge, I had developed an interest in chromatin, the complex of DNA and histone proteins that makes up chromosomes in cells. So I began work on how chromatin was organized, and for a long time was better known for this than for my continuing ribosome work. I still kept plugging away at the ribosome using the techniques I had learned, like neutron scattering. But neither I nor anyone else in the field made real progress in understanding how the ribosome actually worked. Individual components of the ribosome seemed to do little by themselves. It was a bit like looking at a set of tires and pistons in isolation, with no idea of how they were put together to make a car. On the other hand, the whole ribosome seemed too large and intractable a problem on which to make any headway. Not only was the ribosome becoming even less fashionable than when I'd started working on it, but neutron scattering was proving a dead end in tackling it or chromatin. Almost a decade after I'd switched from physics to biology, it looked like my second career was going down the tubes, just like my first one. Chapter 3. Seeing the Invisible. We say seeing is believing, and it is astonishing how often just being able to see things has changed our understanding of the world. For centuries, we had many misconceptions about our own bodies, because our knowledge of them came from the Greek physician Galen, who based it on the dissection of animals. It was only in the 1500s, when Andreas Vesalius started dissecting human corpses, that we started to understand our own anatomy. When it came to seeing the ribosome, however, none of the methods we were using would let us visualize details of the ribosome, let alone how it worked. Before returning to our story, it is worth making a detour into how scientists took half a century to develop a technique that would be key to cracking the ribosome problem. For most of human history, we were limited by what we could see with the naked eye. The detail we could see dramatically expanded in the mid-1600s when a Dutch linen merchant, Antoni van Leeuwenhoek, wanted to examine cloth fibers more closely. In his desire to make better lenses, he would go on to invent the most powerful microscope of his time, which he used to look at everything from pond water to the scum scraped off his own teeth. He was astonished to see small creatures moving around, which he called animalcules, but which we know today as microbes. Soon afterwards, Robert Hooke also used microscopes to look at the details of everything, from fleas to various tissues. He coined the term cell to describe the compartments that made up plant tissues. The idea of the cell completely transformed biology. We now realize that the cell is the smallest unit of life that can exist independently. And cells can associate to form tissues and whole animals. As microscopes became more powerful, people saw that the insides of cells had structures, such as a nucleus with chromosomes and various organelles. Just being able to see detail had transformed biology from the anatomy of humans to the structures inside a cell. But what were all these things inside cells made of?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.